Hail Mary.
Our lesson tonight will be presented by our pastor, Pastor Brown. Hear ye him.
We reverence God and thank him for our being here and thank him for the opportunity to come together and to share in the discussion of the Sunday school lesson for this Sunday, March 31st, is lesson 5 in this series, and it's the resurrection key to faith. And Paul talks extensively in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 about the key element of the resurrection to the faith of believers, to our commitment to the Lord, and to the shaping of the direction that we should be going in. So I would recommend for your personal growth and understanding that you would read 1 Corinthians chapter 15, where it talks in details about the importance, the relevance, the significance of the resurrection. And this is Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. And when the Sabbath was past, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome had bought sweet spices that they might come and anoint him. And very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came unto the sepulchre at the rising of the sun. And they said among themselves, "Who shall roll us away the stone from the door of the sepulchre?" And when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. And entering into the sepulchre, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a long white garment, and they were affrighted. And he said unto them, "Be not affrighted. Ye seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold the place they laid him. But go your way. Tell his disciples and Peter that he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall ye see him as he said unto you." And they went out quickly and fled from the sepulchre, for they trembled and were amazed. Neither said they anything to any man, for they were afraid. This is Mark's sharing of his interpretation and the understanding he received from the resurrection. Our lesson is divided into two sections. First part is verses 1 through 4 of Mark 16, and the subject is the women. And the A of that is their intention, the B of their timing, the C is the trouble. And then part 2 is the messenger, Mark 16, 5 through 8, angelic appearance and remarkable report. Again, I say this is Mark's presentation of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Tradition tells us that the Gospel of Mark was written by John Mark, an associate of Peter and Paul and Barnabas. Acts chapter 12, verse 12, 1 Peter 5 and 13. This man was not an apostle, but he was a close relative of Barnabas. History has told us that he was probably Barnabas' sister's son, which would have made him his nephew. It is believed that Barnabas' sister was the Mary in whose homes the early church met. And there's a lot to learn, and we could talk about Mark, John Mark, but we're not going to focus on that this morning. But if you want to do personal reading, at the end, it's believed that he was the associate that accompanied Peter every way he went. And some call the Gospel of Mark the Gospel of Peter, as revealed to Mark. And it's believed that he directed his gospel to the Romans. The Romans were not interested in no miraculous birth. They really weren't interested in miracles. But the thing that they admired and respected was power and authority. And Mark reveals Jesus as a man of power and authority. The symbol for the book of Mark is an ox. And an ox was a symbol of power, strength, strong. And so John Mark went with Paul and Barnabas on their first missionary journey. And for some reason, there are a lot of, and I mean, the Bible really sort of tells us he got scared. He got scared because Paul started doing stuff like cursing people and they went blind. And that scared John Mark. And so he said, nah, I'm going back. And he was a young man also. And then on the second missionary journey, when Barnabas brought up the name of John Mark, Paul said, he's not going with me. He abandoned us. And I don't want nobody that abandoned me. But later, we know that Paul said, bring John Mark with you, for he is good for me. So they made up, they reconciled. But John Mark had his own history. And he was a man that found himself hanging around long enough to being faithful enough to write one of the gospels. To put him in a disfavor with Paul is one of the things people remember about him, but you have to remember that Paul said at the end that he is good for me. Although Mark's gospel is the shortest of the four, it narrates, his narrative packs a punch. Like I said, you see in Mark a fast-moving, powerful Messiah. It opens up with him going into the wilderness, being tempted, and then coming out, preaching, teaching, and healing. The Gospel of Mark is sometimes called the Gospel of Action because it doesn't have a lot of narration about the birth and all of the other things. The designation stems from the fact that Mark jumps quickly from scene to scene to chronicle Jesus's ministry. The gospel's description of the last week of Jesus' ministry highlights its inclination toward action. Of the nearly 700 verses of the gospel, 241 of them, more than one third of the gospel of Mark, recount events from the last week of Jesus' life, chapter 11 through chapter 16. In describing scenes from that week, the gospel jumped quickly between scenes. Mark tells us how Jesus entered in Jerusalem on the Sunday, taught others regarding righteousness. On that Thursday, he ate a final meal before he was arrested and tried. Finally, on that Friday, he was crucified and killed at the hands of the Roman soldiers. That's Mark 15, chapter verses 16 through 41. Friday evening of that week, Joseph of Arimathea, a member of the Sanhedrin, approached Pontius Pilate alone with Nicodemus to ask for Jesus' body, Mark 15, 43. And before granting the request, Pilate wanted confirmation that Jesus was truly dead. There was to be no doubt on the part of Pilate that Jesus was indeed dead. Once Pilate received this verification, Joseph took Jesus's body and prepared it for burial. Some say because of the lateness of the day that a full preparation had not been done. And the women who normally participate, family members participate in this embalming type process, were not able to fulfill certain things that they like to do. Some say they don't even know what the body of Christ was washed, but we do know that they did place it wrapped in what they considered were those fragrances that would help subdue the odor. They wanted to do what was ritualistically correct for Jesus. Joseph then placed the body in a rock tomb. And because of the insistence of the high priest and the leaders who brought the scenario, of the possibility of his body being stolen, that Rome agreed to put a rock seal on the front of the tomb of Jesus. And so after the burial, two women went and noticed the burial location. You'll find that in the 15th chapter, verse 47. Mary Magdalene and Mary, they knew where Jesus was buried. They would return after Sabbath to finish caring for Jesus's body. Now, I want to just throw something in here, but I don't want to be long about it. And I don't want to let it become controversial because I believe that's the aim and the goal. For many, many years, I mean, it didn't just start, 20, 50 years ago. I would say for hundreds of years, there's been that argument about whether or not Jesus was in the grave 3 days and three nights, as Jonah was in the belly of the whale. And so that discussion has come up lately. But Mark, to me, is very clear on what took place. On a Friday, he was crucified. It was the day of preparation. The next day was the Sabbath day. So before 6 o'clock Friday, he had to be in the grave. And then he got up on the third day morning. And what I wanted to bring to you is, don't allow yourself to get caught up in that argument. It's been going on for hundreds of years. And I just dealt with someone who's trying to question me about it, and they have their idea, and I understand. And some of the stuff they can try to prove, but let me say this to you, and you all think about this. If Jesus was in the grave the full 3 days, 72 hours, then he didn't rise on the third day. He got up on the fourth day. Now, that's one thing. Now, they said on the third day, okay, the second thing of my other argument, and I sent, this is what I put in my closing remarks after giving them scripture and scripture and after sharing, I said, motel, hotel, Holiday Inn. If you check in on Friday before 6 o'clock and you check out Sunday morning before 6 a.m., you're going to be charged for 3 days. Now that's to me, I know that's a simplistic argument, but that satisfied the 3 days for me. Look, look, some students believe that the original ending of this gospel came with the 16th verse. We're not going to debate that because in the other part was added later, but that's not relevant to what the point we are dealing with. We are dealing with the point that the resurrection is the key to our faith. John Mark revealed to us what the women did in Mark 16, 1 through 4, and what their intention was, and what their, and when the Sabbath was passed, Sabbath is Saturday. Sabbath is, you'll hear this argument about a high Sabbath and all of the Sabbath is Saturday. And when the Sabbath was passed, that means it was past 6 o'clock Saturday evening. That's when the Sabbath was passed. When the Sabbath was passed, I mean, let me go and read the scripture, I'm sorry, was passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, had brought sweet spices that they might come and anoint him. Jesus died on a Friday, the day of preparation for the Sabbath, Mark 15, 37 through 42. The law of Moses prohibited work on the Sabbath, Exodus 28 through 11, Leviticus 23 and 3. Therefore, the burial process would have to wait until the Sabbath was passed. If anything that was not done before 6 o'clock on Friday could not be done until after 6 o'clock on Saturday. The task of treating the body of Jesus would fall to the women, some of whom were at the crucifixion and subsequently had seen the tomb's location. The name Mary was a common name in the first century AD. By one estimate, one in four women in the Palestine area was named Mary. The gospel mentions several women named Mary, so it is easy to confuse them. One of the women with that name was a lady called Mary Magdalene. The Bible says Jesus had cast seven demons out of her. And some say that she, her profession was a street girl, but we don't know all of it. But her name is not Mary Magdalene. It is Mary from a place called Magdala. It indicates the city from which she was come. The second Mary is really unknown to us. Some believe that she is the mother of James the Less and of Joses, or J-O-S-E-S, Joseph. Another possibility is that she was the wife of Cleophas, talking about in John 19, 25. Matthew's account of the burial mentions a woman who is the mother of Zebedee's children. That's Matthew 27, 56. This woman could have been Salome, thus making her the mother of James and John. And it is believed that Salome was the sister of Mary, the mother of Jesus. So James and John's were his cousins. Sweet spices combated the stench of decaying flesh. These treatments were an essential part of the burial. The women prepared these things before the Sabbath. They waited for the conclusion of that day of rest to return to the grave and anoint the remains of Jesus. the timing, verse 2 says, and very, very, that's the only one very there, and very early in the morning, the first day of the week. What's the first day of the week? Sunday. That's the first day of the week. So I'm telling you, there are a lot of arguments that did not die in what we call ancient time, didn't die with the Gnostics and the Stoics. Some of those arguments are still alive today. And first question I ask anybody that raised those arguments, is there any salvation in the fact of whether Jesus was in the grave 3 days and got up on the fourth day? Well, no, Reverend, ain't no. We just want to know the truth. I said, there's some truth you're not going to know till God reveals it to you. Some things we have to believe. And this doctrine that we stand on is the teachings of the fathers. This is what we inherited. This is the faith that Jude was contending for. These are the principles that were passed down to us. The phrase is very early in the morning and at the rising of the sun reveal the eagerness of the women to complete their task. We assume that they set out just before sunrise in the dim pre-dawn light. The women were confident of their destination, having been there 2 days earlier. The leaders of the group were confident that they knew exactly where Jesus was. I can see him walking. It's a little bit too dark to make out faces, but we can tell that they are a group of women. And look, they have things in their hands that they're carrying: spices, ointments, myrrh, frankincense. They're headed toward that place. But then somebody remembers the trouble they might encounter. Verse 3, and they said among themselves, who shall roll us away the stone from the door of the sepulchre? What the women seem to have forgotten up to this point is that a massive disc-shaped stone sealed with the seal of Rome had been placed at the entrance of the grave of Jesus Christ. Several strong individuals would be needed to roll it away from the entryway. The women's question reveals that they had belatedly realized that they would not be able to move the stone. But I want to throw this in. They kept walking. Sometimes you don't know how it's going to turn out, but you have to keep walking. They had a divine desire to do something that was pleasing, do something that what they felt was necessary. And they believed that they were on a mission that had the intent of God in it. And so they kept walking. I was amazed when I first went out to Sears Northwest Plaza in the late 70s. And a lot of people were still on the farms. And they would come to the store and they would watch that automatic door. They would, I mean, the whole family standing over to the side, watching people going in the door at the store. And they were just amazed at how that door would open. Amen. And then they would come on up. And the minute they stepped on the pad or broke the signal of the eye, the door would open. And a lot of them, if they had not kept walking, would never have entered into the store, because it would not have received the signal to open up the door. I hope y'all understand what I'm trying to say to you, that a lot of times we may not know how to open up the door or how to get in the door, but if we keep walking by faith in the Lord, hallelujah, these women, even though they came to the conclusion that we got a dilemma, we got trouble up ahead because we don't know how we're going to get past. Plus, Rome has said nobody can go in that grave. Peter in particular denied having known Jesus. Disciples had fled. The women said question about what they were going to do. Because of their grief, shame, and fear, some of Jesus' followers had distanced themselves from associating with him. They would not be of any help in removing the stone from the door of the sepulchre. But look at verse 4. And when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. The gospel accounts of Mark, Luke, and John do not reveal how the stone was rolled away. They only report that the stone was no longer blocking the tomb's entrance when the women arrived. Matthew, however, discloses that the angel of the Lord descended from heaven, came, and rolled back the stone from the door. The massive nature of this very great stone is noted in Matthew 27 and 60. And when they went into that open sepulchre, they meet the messenger of God, verses 5 through 8. An angelic appearance, verse 5 says, and entering into the sepulchre, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a long white garment, and they were affrighted. Mark's gospel does not provide further identification information regarding the young man sitting in the sepulchre. However, we can determine his nature from the other gospel accounts. Matthew 28:2 describes him as an angel of the Lord. Luke identifies two men in shining garments who are angels. And John's gospel, chapter 20, verse 12, is similar. Scripture often describes heavenly beings in terms of the brightness of their garments. The women came to the tomb to care for the body of Jesus. Instead of seeing his body, they saw an unknown visitor. The sight of this mysterious person would have been a valid reason for women to feel affrighted. For anybody who walked in on an angel to be afraid. Here's the remarkable report. And he said unto them, be not affrighted. Ye seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. Fear is a common reaction to seeing an angelic messenger. Judges 13, Matthew 28, Acts 10, or a supernatural occurrence, such as Mark 4 and Mark 5 and Mark 9. When this occurs, a form of the reminder to be not affrighted usually follows, because seeing it can frighten you. The angel's designation, Jesus of Nazareth, referred to the location of Jesus' upbringing. The village of Nazareth, located about 70 miles north of Jerusalem in the hilly region west of the Sea of Galilee. Residents of that village were likely impoverished people. As a result, others held them in low regard. Jesus' parents were from Nazareth. The family returned there after Jesus' birth. Jesus remained in Nazareth until he began his public ministry. 6b says, he is risen. The angel said, he is risen. He is not here. Not he is transitioned or he is transformed. Behold the place where they laid him. There is no spirit leaving. The whole Jesus was gone. Look, behold the place. The angel's proclamation that Jesus is risen does not mean that his spirit went to heaven, leaving behind his dead body. The empty tomb reveals that his physical body was resurrected from the dead. His post-resurrection appearance provided further evidence of this reality. The resurrection should not have come as a surprise to his followers. Jesus had told them. He had prophesied to them numerous times regarding his death and resurrection. However, his disciples rarely understood his teachings on this topic. Burial customs during Jesus' day began with the washing of the body. Then the body was wrapped with clothes or cloths, treated with fragrant spices and ointments, laid upon a flat surface in the grave. The command to behold the place where Joseph had laid him indicated that the tomb no longer contained the body of Jesus. Hallelujah. He was not there. My God, verse 7 says, but go your way. Tell his disciples and Peter that he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall you see him as he said unto you. The command to go and tell of the risen Lord indicates a change in emphasis for Mark. In his gospel, he frequently mentions times when Jesus urged others to be silent regarding his identity and his work. Mark 3:11, Mark 5:42, Mark 7:36, Mark 8:29. Now that Jesus' resurrection has occurred, his followers would not need to remain silent about him. Jesus' disciples had fled at his arrest. On that occasion, they were concerned for their safety. Rather, they punished the disciples for leaving Jesus. The angel's message referred them to a chance to reunite with their Lord. The angels were not to condemn him or to condemn them, but to give them a hope. The angel showed particular attention to Peter by naming him specifically. Except for this place, 16 and 7, the name of Peter was always the first name in the discussion of the disciples. But Peter had fallen after promising Jesus that he would not turn away from him, that he would not leave him, that he would not deny him. And so emphasis by the angel is on the fact, tell the disciples, tell them and Peter, amen. You invited also Peter. Hallelujah. The apostles is known for his position of prominence. And here he thought he had lost his position because of his impulsive behavior. He had confidently proclaimed fidelity to Jesus, even if it led to his death. But we know what happened to Peter. Before Jesus' arrest, he had prophesied that his disciples would be offended and scattered. In the same breath, however, he promised, after that I am risen. This is 14th chapter, verse 28. After that I am risen, I will go before you into Galilee. The angel's message to the women indicated the pending fulfillment of Jesus' promise. The selection of Galilee as the location of this promised reunion was made with intent. Jesus began his public ministry in Galilee. It was in that region that he called his first disciples. The angel's message sent the apostles back to where their relationship with Jesus began. Verse 8 says, and they went out quickly and fled from the sepulcher, for they trembled and were amazed. Neither said they anything to any man, for they were afraid. Now we know later that Mary Magdalene did talk to the angel and ask him, well, really she was talking to Jesus, but she thought she was talking to an angel. Sir, tell me where you laid him that I can take him. And she said to her, Mary, and she said, Lord, she recognized this verse. Three strong emotions overwhelmed the women as they went out quickly and fled from the sepulchre. Their feelings were decidedly mixed. This is the only verse in the New Testament where the Greek word for trembled, amazed, and afraid occur together. The picture was one of uncertainty as the women found themselves in an in-between state. The empty tomb was initial evidence of a miraculous occurrence, but they had not yet seen the risen Jesus personally. So they ran back and they told his disciples what they had received. After receiving the angel's message, the women were afraid and fled from the tomb. Does fear ever prevent you from serving the Lord? When that occurs, remember the words of the resurrected Lord. Fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. Revelation 1, 17 and 18. Believe this. Believe this and have great faith. Believe this and believe and trust in God. So in conclusion, the scripture abruptly ends with the declaration of the women's fear. If this were all we knew of the story, we'd wonder what happened next. Praise God that we know the conclusion of this story, a story that continued with Jesus' ascension after 40 days to heaven, Acts 1, 1 through 9, and will culminate with his promised return to earth in Revelation 22 and 20. The resurrection of Jesus is a singular event in history. It is distinct from other resurrections in the Bible. Those were instances of temporary restoration of physical life. Temporary because all those people who died before Jesus died again. The resurrection of Jesus, by contrast, was a permanent resurrection. Revelation 1:18. That permanence has vital implication. Death is God's penalty for sin. But now the risen Jesus holds the key of hell and death. Another characteristic that set Jesus' resurrection apart from the others noted above is that his body was transformed. Not merely resurrected. After his resurrection, he appeared and disappeared in ways he had not done previously. Although he still had a physical body that other people could touch, that the transformation of Jesus' body prefigures the promised transformation of those who belong to him when we are raised on the last day. From our vantage point some 2,000 years later, the empty tomb is the universal image of Christ's victory over death. The women who found the open tomb that morning had prepared themselves to be confronted with death. But instead, they were confronted with the announcement of life. The reality of death confronts all, and we make preparation for it. We help friends and family members with funeral plannings. We purchase cemetery plots. But the best spiritual preparation is to let our thoughts dwell on resurrection life. Jesus has promised that what was accomplished in him on that third day will be accomplished in us when he returns. The power of life over death that he demonstrated for himself is the same that will instantly and forever transform us. Philippians 3:21, Jesus is Lord over death, having conquered it, that makes him Lord over eternal life, our eternal life. Therefore, as we prepare for death, we keep in mind that the last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. Death is our enemy, but is ultimately a defeated enemy. When Jesus returns, we will be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, death will be no more. Consider the abrupt ending in verse 8 as an invitation to proclaim the good news of the resurrected Christ. The women at the tomb that morning ran in fear. But as they ran in fear, they ran with a task and a new assignment. Our task today is to run in joy with the message of the empty tomb. May we ever proclaim Christ's victory over death. May we never lose sight of the fact that his victory is our victory as well for eternity. Death could not permanently silence Jesus or obstruct God's plan. Will fear silence you from sharing this good news? Fear not. Fear not. Jesus has risen. Praise God. Hallelujah. The resurrection, the key to faith. Brother teacher, brother superintendent, if there are no questions, that is our presentation of the Sunday school lesson.
Remember how he said while he was yet in Galilee?
Remember.